inviting me, but also I'd like to begin with a word of prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, you give us liturgy as a tool to come closer to you, and yet all too often we just don't think much of what we have. We pray that you would be with us, that your Spirit would breathe upon us in this time, that we may come to appreciate where we've been as a people in the last 500 years, and then we pray also that you would instill in us a love for where we're going. Help us to appreciate the words that we pray, that they may indeed instill some life in our spiritual journey. This we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So, just a little background why I'm doing this. At St. Stephen's, we are doing all of the major prayer book revisions during the season of Lent as our Sunday liturgy, and then having the unpacking time and coffee hour. So we've gone a long ways in 500 years since the Reformation. And I'm going to go through these things at probably a pretty good clip. If you have some question, please do not fear raising your hand. I'm happy to stop where I am to meet what your needs are. Okay? Let's begin. What is liturgy, first of all? We have one working definition is a work of the people. It's supposed to be something that's not just a spectator's work. It's a framework to explore scripture. If you look at the way the prayer book is arranged in all of its versions, it is scripture reorganized into to be a prayable format. And it's also an order in which we present religious truths. We have this wonderful tool called the lectionary, and although there have been many different lectionaries during the course of the development of the prayer book, these lectionaries all have a theme. Cram paired them up, in fact, with themes that we experience through the collects of the day. So all of these things then present liturgy, a work of the people. Liturgy is also dynamic. It changes with time, changes with people's needs. The things that were concerning people back in 1549 aren't concerns anymore. And as we get into some of the first revisions of the prayer book, we're going to see that some of their concerns seem, well, rather ridiculous to us now. And we'll get to that in a minute. It reflects a changing world, changes in language. We don't always pray in these and thous. I assume that the Pro-Cathedral is primarily a write-to place. Yeah, okay. As most churches are, it reflects the changing language. Reflects scientific discoveries. Some of our prayers change when we understand the world a little bit differently. And I also want to say there is no golden age of liturgy. There is no wonderful ideal time that if we could just go back to that time, we would have pure, unadulterated worship that was truly Anglican and pleasing. It doesn't work that way. We have things that have to fit to our needs today. 1549, when we start having the liturgy in English, first of all, let's look at what happened that is the predecessor to how the prayer book worked. The English people never fully accepted the authority of the Pope. The idea that Henry VIII wanted a divorce, that started the Church of England, is a bunch of malarkey. It was the political thing that made the Anglican Church happen, but the people were never really sold on it. English liturgies have a strong Celtic influence. The world also, at that time, until the Council of Trent, had lots of different rites of being Catholic. So there's a Gallican rite in France, and there's a Mozarabic rite in Spain. And all over the world, there were all these little rites with little different variations on what they did. So Henry's break just dealt with authority. Henry was a Catholic through and through. He did not like the idea of priests marrying. Liturgy was still in Latin. Henry was very anti-Lutheran. One of the ways that we know this, he got this funny title, Defender of the Faith, which has been passed down through English monarchs ever since. He got that title given to him by the Pope because he wrote a treatise against Martin Luther. Now we kind of laugh at that with our ecumenical partnerships with the Lutherans being so strong. Henry did not like the idea of the Bible being translated into English. In fact, one of the people that opposed him so much was William Tyndale. William Tyndale had translated vast majority of the scriptures along with an Anglican bishop by the name of Miles Coverdale. And it was so problematic to Henry that he had him executed. And William Tyndale's last words as he was burning were, "Lord, open the eyes of the king." 3 years later, Henry mandated that Tyndale's work was going to be in every English church. Henry dies in 1547, and the act of succession that puts the monarchs in order meant that Edward VI, who you can see in the bottom of your screen there, becomes the king at the age of 9. Very sickly child. He's been reared by Protestants who came over from Germany. And Cranmer sees this as an opportunity. This is his golden way of being able to make truly English worship reformed. Although what he sees as reformed and what he will see as reformed are two different things. We're going to get to that in a minute. So Cranmer's reforms were, now clergy could marry. Interestingly, Cranmer already had married. He married in Germany, brought over his wife. When his, you know this story? Okay, when Mary Tudor, the eldest daughter of Henry, ascends to the throne, she has to go into hiding, so she's put into a trunk. Cranmer is uncomfortable wrestling with some of the ceremonial that had crept its way into the Latin Mass, so he attempted to kind of strip that down. Minor revisions were included as the Mass is translated in English. One of the things that we think of as rather bizarre is, you know how, and I assume you do this, when we say the words of institution as we're consecrating the bread and the wine, we hold it up so everybody can see. Well, that was one of the things that Cranmer stripped away. The idea, this might be superstition. 1549 prayer book, in use for only 3 years. Composed of three different sources. The Sarum Rite, which was the liturgy of Salisbury Cathedral, which most parish churches used that. It was, however, in Latin. And the Reformed Roman Breviary, this is where we get the daily offices from, including the office of Compline and Noonday Prayer, which you only now have in your 1979 prayer book. That's restored. And also a book of doctrine and liturgy by a fellow from Cologne in Germany. That's where we get the first catechism from. The first prayer book did not have any ordination rites. That develops later. Reflections on the 1549. What, and any reflections you have on what it means to be Reformed and Catholic at the same time? What does that mean for you? Because we're really going to go from really Catholic to really Reformed really quick. One of the things that you've noticed in English churches and color schemes are very different from what we're used to now. We're used to violet in Lent, at least I assume you all are. And most churches in North America are. The dye, however, is very expensive. So most parish churches would not be able to afford something with purple dye. We clothe our bishops with it. We make it a sign of royalty. In England, they used sackcloth, blood red, and ash as the colors for Lent. Also, we find that Advent, Salisbury Cathedral that I had mentioned earlier, used a faded old black cloth on their altar that in the right light looked blue. So that's why some Anglican churches use blue in Advent. Music. Singing in parts is big during this time, but the very few churches that had organs weren't really good organs at this point. They didn't stay in tune. So most parish churches didn't have them. Too expensive. Congregational singing is very limited. And the first reforms we begin to see with music begin with the 1552, the second prayer book. Because while the music is lovely and florid at the time of the Reformation, Cranmer thinks this too is vain. And he thinks this needs to be reformed. So they start looking at the way that music is done on the continent in Geneva. and the reforms done by Calvin had emphasized one syllable, one note. You don't want all this florid stuff, because after all, music is supposed to teach, right? Or so was the thought, not a sense of just enjoying it. Also, postures are different. You may have been at some point in the church. I know the church in Harvard is like this. The sanctuary is oriented so that the altar is against the wall. The priest faces in the same way that the congregation does. It's a sign of leadership. It's not meant to be off-putting. He's not turning his back to you. He's showing you which way to go. And so it also reflects an expectation of resurrection. This posture was a way it had been all through the High Middle Ages, and that too will change with the second prayer book. That posture being facing the same way was common in our Episcopal churches until the 1960s, in which case the reforms of Vatican II began to influence us, and we said perhaps we need to look at the way the very ancient church worshipped, which was gathered around a tomb, which is with the first altars, and that's why many altars had relics in them, a way of keeping that celebrating on the tombs alive. Okay, the 1549 includes a lot of the language that we know of as classic Rite One. It sounds almost, though, when you hear it, as though it has been chopped up with scissors, because it's very disarranged. It includes the peace. How many of you all like the peace? You like sharing with your neighbors. You really like the peace. But the peace disappears after this point, and it doesn't show up in any prayer book until we get it back in 1979. Also interesting is that at this time, Cranmer asserts, along with a reformer by the name of Jan Hus, who was a forerunner of Lutheranism, said everybody needs to have the opportunity to get the precious blood as much as they get the body. And at that point, for fear of spilling the cup, they weren't administering the cup to lay people. The Reformation in England changed that. Problems with this prayer book, and most of the prayer books all the way up, really, we start having a little bit more cooperation in 1884. But before that, the prayer books were rather dry in terms of lay people's response. I did the 1549 at St. Stephen's this past Sunday, and the first remark that was shared with me afterwards when we were unpacking what happened was, we felt really dumb. There wasn't anything for us to do. You say a couple of amens, you have the responses to the Sursum Corda, and that's about it. 1552, Cranmer is influenced by Calvin and Zwingli. Edward VI, the king, is also sympathetic with these radical reforms, and one of the things that's challenged is what we understand to happen at the altar. Is it true body and blood? Is it changed? Is it just a memorial? And so, siding with a reformer by the name of Zwingli, Cranmer decided we are not going to teach the real presence. There was concerns that Catholic traditions encourage superstition and belief in magic. One of the things that disappears in the 1552 prayer book is our whole concept of celebrating using hands. The altars were taken down. Tiny little communion tables were set up lengthwise in between the choir stalls. And the priest would stand on the north side with his side facing you for most of the liturgy. When it came time to consecrate the elements, his hands went to his back so that the people could see. There was no touching, no hocus pocus, which of course comes from the old Latin as hocus corpus meus, this is my body, which they wanted to make sure nobody was going to have any of that superstition. Churches were stripped of crosses and candles and hangings and statuary, anything that was on the surfaces of the wall, for example, if there was a fresco, they were going to whitewash over that. This is the beginnings of the high church, low church war, because some people really liked the 1549. Finally got the Mass in English, but it was really Catholic. And then you have the 1552, very Protestant, and the two just never saw eye to eye. I am going to just fast forward through some of these things. Vesture changed at this point. Priests no longer are wearing chasubles. They're wearing scarves, which really had the function of just keeping them warm in unheated churches. They weren't there to demonstrate any form of priestly leadership. Also, we have the insertion in the 1552 of the Ten Commandments as being a big part of the liturgy. That would go all the way through the 1928 prayer book. And the idea being so important that people learned the Ten Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, that placards were put up where the altar crosses used to be so you could read them, because most churches could not afford these new prayer books. The words Mass and altar are gone. They're replaced then with the Lord's Supper and table. And these words you still find a little mixture of when you pick up the 1979 prayer book. Some places it's referred to as altar, some places it's referred to as holy table, some places it's priest, some places it's minister. Also deleted, a very important little prayer that probably you maybe never have noticed when the Eucharistic prayer is being said. A little prayer called the Epiclesis. And it was a classic thing that was included in the Serb liturgy, included in Rome's rite as well. The idea, you might have seen the celebrant do this upon the elements after they've been blessed. The idea of calling down the Holy Spirit, it's stripped because we don't want, again, the assertion that something special is happening here. It's just a reminder. It's that prayer that gets put back in the first American prayer book, because we had to get our bishops from Scotland, or our first bishop at least. Also interesting is this funny thing in the end of 1552 called the Black Rubric. All the rubrics, the word rubric means red print, and all the prayer books at this point would have been printed twice, first with red ink and then with black ink. The words you say are in black, the things you do are in red. But it was added after the fact because they thought that they needed to make a very firm statement. Again, we are not going to be English Catholics. We are going to be English Reformed people. So they were instructed to make their communion on their knees, but then also told that there cannot be Jesus in two places at one time. There cannot be Jesus here on earth at the same time he's up in heaven, which is a load of malarkey. But that is what they believe. 1552 is used only for 6 months, and then we have the lovely five-year reign of Mary Tudor. And all of England becomes Roman Catholic again. The reformist bishops go out into exile, and they get a new leader of English Catholic Christianity, Reginald Pole. 280 dissenters. People like Bishops Ridley and Latimer, and a year later after that, Cranmer, all are burned alive as heretics. 1559 is when Mary Tudor dies. Yet Elizabeth ascends the throne, and Elizabeth has seen her family rent asunder by all kinds of religious controversies. And she becomes the master of compromise. So she engineers something we call the Elizabethan settlement. It reestablishes the prayer book. It claims that Rome has no jurisdiction, but there's a certain amount of Catholic ceremonial that she allows. And after a discussion with her privy council, some things that she wants are admissible and some things she doesn't get. It merged the Protestant theology of the 1552 with the classic Catholic theology of 1549. Now, here's where you will see the remnants of this Elizabethan settlement if you open up your 79 prayer book. The words that you are handed the sacrament with are this settlement. 1549 prayer book said, "The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for thee, preserve thy body and soul unto everlasting life." 1552 says, "Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for thee, thankful." The fact that they were both used was that compromise. This theology is the beginnings of our talk of via media, which is a pretty big Anglican concept. We have one hand that reaches out as having our history in Rome and also being fully reformed at the same time. Elizabeth wanted all the altars back with candles and crosses, and vestments and real presence, and abolishing the black rubric. She only gets about half these things. She doesn't get the candles and crosses back, and the black rubric stays, but the altars are set back up. They start doing eastward-facing mass again. And the way that she engineered so that all of this could happen is something called the ornaments rubric. And it is, and here it is to be noted, that such ornaments of the church and of the ministers thereof at the times of their ministration shall be retained as be in use as were in this Church of England by authority of Parliament in the second year of the reign of King Edward VI. So we've come somewhat back into a more Catholic sense of Anglicanism. Also during this time, we get some really incredible theologians. We get Richard Hooker, who is apologist to the Puritans. I bet you may not know who Richard Hooker is, but I assure you all know probably what he talked about. The three-legged stool, scripture, tradition, and reason, which really, according to Hooker, is more of a three-runged ladder. But the idea being these three things are pretty important things for our the understanding of our faith. John Jewell was an apologist to the Roman Catholics. John Jewell teaches us that Anglicanism embodies everything of the primitive church, of conciliar Christianity, the early church, where the bishops were all paired up with one another in sort of a college instead of one bishop having authority over others. Colonization at this time begins in earnest. Great Britain had the strongest naval fleet in the world, and everywhere that they brought their ships and their trade, they also brought missionaries, and they brought the gospel. This is why you go in some places like, for example, at St. Stephen's, we have a Sudanese congregation. And the Sudanese are used to using forms of worship that go back to this time, because that was the prayer book that they had. You look at the prayer book of South Sudan, and you find out it really does look like 1559. Francis Drake, who's a friend of the Queen, uses the 1559 prayer book to celebrate the first Anglican use Eucharist in America in what is now San Francisco Bay. The 1559 lives on for 90 years. And then it's outlawed by the Long Parliament. Things are beginning to change, and a little party called the Puritans is coming to power. King Charles and Archbishop Laud are executed. Both are high churchmen, and they're not known for really being able to get along with other people. Charles believed very strongly in the divine right of kings, and Laud would have loved everything to go back to the way things were in the Sarum Missal, except in English. Oliver Cromwell leads an 11-year protectorate. It's also called the interregnum, because there is no king during this time. Parliament reigns supreme. And the Church of England then becomes functionally, not theologically, but functionally Presbyterian. The bishops go overseas. 11 years, the Puritans are in power. That's Oliver Cromwell. He looks like a relatively nasty guy, doesn't he? English bishops are in exile, and the churches use something called the Westminster Directory. My seminary has a copy of this, and I used to tease that I wanted to break it in the middle of the night to burn it. Some churches were using the 1559 prayer book illegally. And talk about how low things have become. When you see clergy, or for that matter, choirs dressed for daily office, you have an undergown called a cassock, and then you have a white overgown called a surplice. The surplice is outlawed. It seemed to be way too high church. Christmas is made illegal. The original Grinch, right?
Yes.
A fellow by the name of John Evelyn records how he goes to church for Christmas Mass, and they come in with guns drawn. 1662, with the death of Oliver Cromwell, then the nation gets a chance to go back to its prayer book roots, and the English people loved their prayer book. It needs a little bit of revision at this point, though. It's 112 years old, so it needs some, just a little minor facelift. It's still the authorized Book of Common Prayer in Great Britain today. Now, they use something called common worship, which puts everything in right two-ish kind of sounding language. But this is the official prayer book, because the official prayer book would have to have the approval of Parliament. This is the beginnings of the format that we now recognize in Rite One, where prayers of the people then become separate from the liturgy of the table. At this point, before this, it was all kind of run together as one. So you had the prayers of the people, the confession, the prayer of humble access, and the Eucharistic prayer kind of mushed and muddled together. Now we're starting to see it separate. There's a firm rubric about announcements, too, which also reinforced this concept of clericalism. You know, priests did everything back then. Lay people administering the chalice? Nah, wouldn't happen. Deacons were allowed to administer the chalice, but not lay people. Lay people taking communion out to sick people? No, didn't happen. Needed at least a deacon for that. At this point, they're saying, if you're going to stand up and make an announcement at church, it's where, I assume you all have announcements at a particular time. Where do you all have your announcements?
At halftime.
At halftime. Guess why you have it at halftime? Why? 1662.
Really?
That's where they put it. Many high church practices are recovered at this point. No crosses, no candles still. 1662 mandates the handling of the bread and wine. We've got these lovely little A, B, and C rubrics in there that say the priest has to touch it. And a few years later, in 1702, there's a revision that takes place in the catechism that says the reason that you have to touch it is because we do believe in the real presence. Funny how things all come full circle. The priest must treat consecrated and unconsecrated elements differently. The rubrics even say in previous prayer books, if you consecrate it, the curate can take it home and do what he wants to with it. Here it says, if it's consecrated, you consume it. If it's unconsecrated, then you there's theological updates. We begin having a thanksgiving for the departed. Before this, you never prayed for dead people, because according to Calvin, if they were saved or not saved, we knew that at the time that they died, and there's nothing you can do about it now. Now we see that there's a prayer for those people. Too late for you. Too late. There is also an appeal that we might emulate the lives of the saints. Popish plot here. Saints are actually important. Imagine that. Give us grace so to follow the good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. And the darn old black rubric stays around because the Presbyterians want to keep it there. 1789, the first American book. Americans are fighting the War of Independence. Anglican clergy are often loyalists. Doesn't make us too, yes, Tories. Very unpopular. Several years under the Articles of Confederation, our nation was essentially powerless. We could not raise money to fund an army. I mean, we just were a nation that was a ship without a rudder. And add to that we had been functioning for, about 150 years without bishops, except when they would ship them overseas, in which case many people, when you took that almost 3-month voyage across the Atlantic, a lot of people died. And so England would not provide us with missionary bishops. Well, lo and behold, we just won a war against them. And so we had to get our bishops from a different place, which leads us to the first bishop we ever had, which is Samuel Seabury. This consecration is performed in 1784 by Scottish non-juror bishops, and at least three bishops have been necessary for consecrating a new bishop since the 4th century. And that's just been mandatory. The idea being, if you have a bunch of bishops together, then if one of their line of succession for some reason wasn't valid, then the episcopate would not die out. Somebody's hands were validly ordained. The non-jurors required that if we were going to have Samuel Seabury, we had to put that funny prayer I call the Epiclesis back in our Book of Common Prayer. And they were happy to do that. After Seabury is consecrated, the English bishops relent. Now we have one bishop, so they participate in subsequent consecrations. Until we have William White and Samuel Provost, all three of them were the first three presiding bishops of the church, and the three of them together then constitute the succession we have in the American church now. Hymnody is introduced in 1789 prayer book time. Hymnody, though, in American churches was a little bit different than hymnody in English churches because our choirs were different. English choir structure is like you have upstairs. Split choir. Oftentimes it's with sopranos and altos on one side and tenors and basses on the other. They didn't have that in the American churches. They had west galleries. Have you ever been in a church that had a balcony up in the back?
Yeah,
it has that as well. Very well equipped then.
Yes.
Okay. Unlike Lutherans that had chorales, Anglican music is austere. It's very plain. We had metrical songs. Metrical songs are some of the driest church music ever. They usually were sung in unison. They were sung to the same format over and over again. And they would take the biblical psalms, play with the words so that it met up with meter, and then that was all you sang. That's all the Calvinists sang too. We have one of these that every one of you all will still know. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. You know that tune. That's a metrical psalm. Now we have the influence of people like the Baptists who were singing about theology and where it meant practice. It's not a biblical text, but it teaches the biblical text. And they also conveyed religious fervor. America was great, a great place to get out of the dryness of being English and the fervor of being American. 1789 prayer book in use for 102 years. Prayer book revisions have happened a lot less frequently during this middle time of Anglicanism. It's replaced by the 1884 with very minor alterations. But most churches at this point have morning prayer as the principal Sunday service. Again, a leftover of the Calvinists. If we do it too often, it would get to be a little less special, or so the thought was. 8 o'clock services start to show up. 8 o'clock services, though, become popular for certain people who want to make a weekly communion. A certain fellow by the name of John Wesley is living about this time, too. And his group, the Methodists, or the Bible Moths, were Anglicans who really had latched onto this idea, you know, we really should have a weekly communion. And people really should pray the daily office in their homes, morning and evening prayer together with their families. That's really high church kind of stuff. Now we don't think of Methodists as being very high church, but the initial movement was. Music becomes a major change now as metrical psalms are no longer in fashion. There's also in 1884, the revision in 1884, some explicit sacrificial language that are added. You're going to remember this. Terms like, we now offer unto thee, and with these thy holy gifts. These are throwbacks from 1549 that are put back in. The addition also reverses Cranmer's initial rejection of the Eucharist as a material sacrifice. The alteration modifies the church's Eucharistic theology to be actually very much in keeping with Roman theology and Orthodox theology. Take note of that little wooden cross up there. The Oxford Dons in the 1840s, teachers at Oxford University, Keeble, Pusey, and Newman meet and begin publishing something called Tracts for the Times. And the Oxford movement, which really is a spiritual movement looking at the original foundations of the Church of England, gives way to the ritualists. And the ritualists want to restore Catholic ceremonial into Episcopal services. The first altar cross to grace the top of an altar in America happens at Neshota House in 1863. That is a picture of it. It sits on one of the chapel altars, made by a student. That thing caused an awful lot of controversy. You'd understand it if it was gold, right? Or if it was something flashy, not made out of pine from the woods of Wisconsin. Midwestern churches during this time are decidedly more high church. As the frontier is settled, the ideas and ideals of the Oxford movement and the ritualist movement are spreading west. The East Coast churches still look very colonial, stripped down, look like the 1789 prayer book without any of these accretions of Romanism. Parishes begin informally also praying for dead people. Again, that never happened before. Prayers including, grant them continual growth in thy love, which is a response to the carnage seen in the Civil War. Mind you, 2% of Americans died in the Civil War. If we have 0.5% now going into a given battle that died, it's considered a bloodbath. And here, 2% of Americans died. We also begin praying that we and all others who shall be partakers of these holy mysteries, because an interesting little thing has started showing up in Midwestern churches, tabernacles. The idea that we can take communion to sick people, and it does not have to be consecrated in their presence. It can be consecrated at the altar and then brought by a deacon or priest. This concept of reservation of the sacrament begins with John Henry Newman's tract number 90, which is also the one where Newman begins to wrestle with, well, do I really want to stay in the Church of England or should I become a Roman Catholic? Rome received him with open arms and then later made him a cardinal. The church also now will bury people who have died as a result of their own hands. It was previously seen that if you committed suicide, you were a lost soul. And the church is beginning to wrestle with this concept of mercy. Customs are changing. 1900, not very long ago. Considered scandalous, but the bishop of Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, Charles Grafton, adopted the use of copes and mitres for liturgy. Even invited other liturgical churches with apostolic succession to the consecration of his successor. The successor, by the way, was a Florida boy. Ended up in Wisconsin. Might see how he's important to me. This was the birth of the ecumenical movement, and also a clear sign that the church is becoming progressive and yet Catholic in identity. 1928, the one that descended from on high with the zipper around the edge and was given to a lot of you at confirmation, I assume. The good old prayer book. Again, it's a response to war. The Great War. Lots and lots of death. What does it mean to be living now in a modern age? And it arrives in the pews right before Black Tuesday brings us into the Depression. Liturgical changes. It shortens the reciting of the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue, into just initial statements, not all of Exodus 20. The Lord's Prayer and the Prayer of Humble Access went back to the places where they were in 1549. Now, we ask ourselves, is this appropriate? In light of the suggestions of the ritualists, people began altering the book. The 1928 prayer book, probably from the 1940s on, was not always used as it was written. We began to question things like the Gloria, In those days, the glory of was put at the end. We worked from darkness into light. We went from the Ten Commandments, fallen humankind, to the heights of heaven and glory. Seems strange to have the glory at the end. But it also seems really strange to have the glory in Lent or Advent. And it was used that way. The rubric said you had to do it. But certain priests began playing with the order of things. They started moving things around, like, say, the creed, which was curiously before the sermon, they started putting after the sermon, because that's what everybody else did. In short, many churches are just not using it as it's written. So in 1950, General Convention authorized the task force to go and revise the prayer book. Things like civil rights are happening at this time. We have Brown versus Board of Education, 1954. There's ecological concerns. The Vietnam War, we really start, well, it's called Indochina in the 50s, but it really starts escalating in the early 60s. The counterculture, making the needs of the church different from what they used to be. And then we had the 70s. Women are proved to be as deacons, so we can't just say, he, without putting it in italics anymore, in the ordination rites. We get these lovely trial liturgies. The blue, you remember the blue book? Remember the blue, you remember the zebra book?
Absolutely. I still have one.
You still have it? I have a zebra book too. Trial rites include rite one, traditional language, but they also, in the earlier blue book, had all the rites in contemporary language. They thought that the old language, the old right one language, would just extinguish really quickly. Nobody is going to ever want to use that old language ever again. Ha. We're going to get back to that in just a second. It's 1974, we have the Philadelphia 11. Women are regularly ordained as priests by retired bishops. And then 2 years later, all of those are regularized, and then now suddenly, all three orders are open to women as well as men. So the 79 had to deal with a lot of these different issues. So the new prayer book is released. It causes a firestorm of controversy. Lots of people do not like it. And roughly a third of the church leaves and joins the ABC continuing church movement of disgruntledness. The Eucharist got an overhaul. We got opening acclamations. We didn't start with the Lord's Prayer and the Collect for Purity as it had been done all the way back to the Reformation. We got new confession language. We deleted the comfortable words and the prayer of humble access for Rite 2. You can still have it in Rite 1. It's just not included in Rite 2. It never was part of Lutheranism. It never was part of Romanism. That's just peculiar Anglican stuff. The fourfold order becomes really important, too. A priest by the name of Dom Gregory Dix said that the Eucharistic narrative was not the Passover meal. He said it was a covenant meal. And this covenant meal would have been something that would have been common in Jewish culture. And if you look at the feeding of the 5,000 in all four of the gospel accounts, it all follows the same pattern. Take, bless, break, share. The breaking of the bread at its ceremonial place in the 1979 is because of his scholarship. It hasn't ever shown up anywhere else. But it's interesting how many other churches have this same return to some very old and patristic sources of liturgy. Laypersons are now authorized to handle the chalice. You don't have to be a deacon anymore. And in 1991, they allowed laypersons to bring communion to homes as an extension of the Eucharist. So if you were going to go into the tabernacle and fill up a kit and take the bread and wine to a sick person, you needed to be a deacon. But if you were going to do it as an extension, if you were sent out with this kit from the altar at the time of Mass, then lay people could do it. We have pretty clear evidence that lay people were doing that in the early church. We have four authorized hymnals. We have a book called Lesser Feasts and Fasts. Starts in 1991 with a rather limited list of approved saints. Now we have two other volumes that have come out since then, and we have people who perhaps never darkened the doorstep of an Episcopal or Anglican church. I still, everybody of course has their favorite saint, I still hope in my lifetime to see Fred Rogers added to that list. In 1990, we get this wonderful supplemental book called Enriching Our Worship. There's actually two volumes of it now, and there are ways in which little minute changes can be made to the 1979 liturgy or entire Eucharistic prayers as well. Part of that sense that liturgy is something that's evolving, and the way that you get ready for the next revision of the prayer book is you're praying in some pockets these things as well. Also interestingly, you can call the 79 prayer book really a book of liturgy better than you can call it common prayer. Because common prayer asserts that everybody's praying the same thing. And with six different options for Eucharist, and some churches that aren't even saying a Eucharist on a Sunday, mean it's really not all that common anymore. 1999, called the Common Mission, unites the Episcopal Church and the ELCA, makes our ministries interchangeable. So now, we've gone through, at breakneck speed, just shy of 500 years worth of liturgy. And not too many of you raised up hands. Did I totally overload you with information? So now we ask the question of what's next. General Convention has invested resources, this past General Convention, into asking, are we ready for a new prayer book in hymnal? Most of God's people in our pews are saying, over my dead body. Many churches, however, no longer use the Book of Common Prayer in their pew. Do you all use the prayer book?
No, it's printed in full.
Printed in full, the same way that we are at St. Stephen's.
But the book is in the pews if they want it.
If you want it, yes.
Yeah.
Trial liturgies are surfacing all the time. Getting anything into print and agreed to at two general conventions is going to be next to impossible. So it's likely that the next version may be electronic and not even in print at all. It may be that we, like England, who still has the 1662, 1979 might be our last actual prayer book. I can hope, right? Final thoughts. Common prayer, as I said, is a myth. Even when there was one right for Mass, some people were doing morning prayer. Churches that can't afford a priest, have no ability to get that sort of ministrations, they're doing the best they can. And sometimes having too many options also seeks to divide us. Many people are calling that this next prayer book be a return to a more sense of common prayer, with one or maybe two rites only. One of the suggestions I have heard is that perhaps we would word it in traditional language in italics, kind of like the way we said his or her, and that way it could be translated off the cuff into common language if that were the choice of the congregation. The compilers of the 1979 prayer book, which has no traditional rite for baptism, has no traditional rite for confirmation. The only thing you can do in both Rite 1 and Rite 2 language is you can go to Mass and you can be buried, because they assumed that it was going to go extinct. They did not realize that millennials like traditional language. They like Rite 1. When I went to seminary, I was amazed that the year I was born and older tended to prefer Rite 2. And all of those who are younger than me all adored Rite 1. Go figure. I would also think that the whole House of Bishops would probably want to retire out before they'd have to deal with the problems of another prayer. And that is it, except to field your questions. Yes?
Earlier you were talking about praying for the dead. When did All Souls Day
When did Requiem Masses become something?
We celebrate All Souls Day.
Right.
Is that something that has always been, or, and we couldn't pray for the dead, and maybe I missed it.
Okay, well, let's go back to the historic reasons for masses for the deceased. In high Middle Ages theology, masses for the dead were a function to get people out of purgatory, a concept that they really don't even understand, because purgatory is a transition, it's not a physical place, if you read Rome's documents. So this idea, this common, not necessarily even theologically well thought out tradition, came into being because people were scared. The reformers looked at this and said, this is superstitious. If we look at the words of the Bible says that if we're absent from the body, we're present with the Lord. So why do we keep doing this? So they stripped it. In the 1884 prayer book, people are looking at having a little bit more expanded sense of caring for the memory of the deceased. It used to be, the 1552 prayer book, for example, when you buried somebody, you didn't bury them from the church. You met at the gravesite. The deceased was never even mentioned by name. There was a committal service, and that was it. Because they didn't want people to have all of the misunderstandings that were common in the medieval church. Now, that being said, though, the Civil War changes a lot of that. And the Great War, World War I, also. And so with the influence of the ritualists, they said, perhaps we can restore this and then recognize that since we grow in the beatific vision, we grow into who God wants us to be, even in heaven, we can couch in using those words instead of prayers to spring us out of purgatory, still legitimately and truly in an Anglican way, still pray for the dead. So that's when it starts. It's that right at the cusp of the 20th century where we start seeing that again. There is a devotional guild called the Guild of All Souls, which actually covenants with individual members to pray for people on the list of the deceased. And then in return for being a member, you get your name on that list when you die, and they pray for you daily for 20 years. So if that's something that's really important, that still does exist. Yes?
In terms of framing, I always took that to mean that that you could be, whatever your polity was, we could pray together that way, not so much that we'd be praying the same services, I guess, or saying precisely
the same. The book is a unifier.
Yeah.
Whether or not are using the same rite or not, yes, yeah. That book can be a good point. Anything else?
Yes.
Back in the 90s when I started coming here, our dean at that time was, before the service of court, he would hold up the bread and say, blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this bread book, and so on and so forth. Is that part of an offertory?
That's Jewish.
Yeah, that is Jewish. Those are table. Blessed are you, O Lord God, King of the universe. Through your goodness, we have this bread to offer, which earth is given.
That's my dad's
made us become for us the bread of heaven.
Right.
Yes.
And I still kind of mumble it to myself when I hold it up. Yeah.
That was done, and it was done in secret. One of the things that the prayer book did not like from its very early starts is it didn't like secret things. The secret things were like magic. So the secret prayers, another one of those ones is when they go up to the altar, they would say a prayer. Well, in England, they say that said a prayer that was attributed to Alcuin. And Alcuin wrote that, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, called to purity. That was a secret. Cranmer said, nope, if you're going to say it, you say it out loud. So everybody can tell what's going on. There's no magic fingers.
Except when you're doing your ablution, in which case you're murmuring a psalm.
Psalm 36.
Yep. That's right.
I wash my hands in innocence.
Doing that again.
I can do that.
The,
I can do it if you want. Wow, I liked it. I liked it. I've been in congregation.
But you don't know what to say. Blessed be God forever.
Yeah. But you guys are so busy singing. I don't want to interrupt you.
Yeah, interest, that is where it's appropriate. If there's something sung, you know, typically say that out loud. Yeah.
You could do it at the 8 o'clock.
That's true.
I could. I do a couple manner of things at 8 o'clock. I don't do it at 10. So I'm clear up on the lines or stuff like that.
Any other questions? Thank you for having me.
Oh, this has been very interesting.